Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening. CEO of THET, Ben Sims, Deputy Director General, Dr. Tedros, distinguished speakers, experts and officials and scientists from academia, civil society, government, private sectors who are attending this virtual conference from around the world. Warm greetings from Myanmar. It is my distinct privilege to deliver a short talk at the THET's annual conference. I'll be reflecting the conference theme from the developing country's perspective and also in the context of the support given from the Tropical Health and Education Trust THET, UK Department of Health. All countries are struggling and putting their human resources and other resources to contain and stop this unprecedented and unexpected emergence of COVID-19. My view on COVID-19 is that people's or community involvement is crucial and will directly influence the quantum of spread, the transmission pattern, the speed of transmission, and the duration of the pandemic. I would like to emphasize four basic points. One is the degree of involvement of the people and the community. The degree of synchronized coordination on prevention, control, and containment efforts carried out by several entities at the country level. The cohesiveness of the combined intervention measures carried out by the Ministry of Health, relevant ministries, and community-based organizations. And the degree of commitment and leadership of countries concerned, that is solidarity. During this COVID period, many regular health programs are slowed down. Some even go to a grinding halt. Some walk off and on. This is a very dreadful situation, I should say, especially the expanded program immunization, programs on non-communicable diseases, programs on maternal and child health, and programs on tuberculosis and HIV. It can have huge negative implications for many years, and it will take time to restore back to the original momentum or walk. It may take even years. I strongly urge that all health program managers, policy makers, and decision makers working at the higher level to start collectively think as to how to restart or kickstart the health program as soon as the COVID situation is somewhat under control. Even in one country, the intensity of spread, the quantum of spread are not equal. In other words, we can start all these programs taking sufficient preventive measures, especially social distancing, in areas of the country where the COVID prevalence is somewhat low. We should start or kickstart all the program as soon as possible without waiting COVID to come to a grinding halt. COVID will be there for many years, although with different intensities and transmission until the effective and efficacious vaccine is developed. Several waves of different intensity of COVID will be happening in many countries in the coming months or years. We have to live with that situation. So we have to think of how to live with the situation. And at the same time, we are not giving this COVID infection. That is very important for all of us. And the strategies that need to do may be different from country to country. While all the countries are focusing or giving attention to COVID, we should not forget the theme of this conference, which is Health for All, a Decade to Deliver. Why? For several decades, all countries have been objectively working very hard to improve the population health status through the application of principles and approaches inherent in the theme of Health for All or No Health for All. In other words, it would be a failure if our healthcare delivery system will be neglecting, or in other words, restarting or kickstarting back the health programs while tackling this COVID-19. Here, I would like to appreciate and thank the health partnership between Myanmar and UK institution, which is ever growing to the benefit of the medical community in Myanmar, and therefore to the population at large, who are getting quality services or quality care because of the support given by THET program. And THET program, I should say, unwavering and ever-increasing support we receive from THET's program. The people involved in THET's programs are very energetic, highly committed to help my country because of a long historical background or relationship between the United Kingdom and Myanmar. I wish that THET should seriously consider expanding this partnership with many other developing countries in Asia, Africa, South America, and the rest of the world. Why I said like this? Because the support given by THET are realistic, directed to those technical areas in need of the country, forward-looking, innovative, and action-oriented. There are several programs that THET is supporting us, like better health programs, public health England activities, several webinars, and capacity building activities for faculty of University of Medicine in my country. A case in point is the Cambridge Yangon Trauma Intervention Project, established 7 years ago to promote multidisciplinary relationship. This is very important, to promote multidisciplinary relationship of trauma, ICU care, physiotherapy, pathology, and neurotrauma. This is very innovative and extremely beneficial to a developing country like Myanmar, where accident rates are rising and take the top 5 morbidity pattern in many hospitals in my country. It may be the same for many low and middle income countries. Another area which I would like THET to replicate and expand in other THET supporting developing countries all over the world is RCGP GP Society Partnership. I consider this as a very special one as it builds up the capacity and safe practice of frontline general practitioners. When I'm saying general practitioners may be quite different from the GPs of United Kingdom. In my country, GPs, they run small clinics and cater to the needs of the population by charging a certain amount of fees. That is a GP in my country. The project is directly supporting the conferencing as well, Health for All, a Decade to Deliver. Another major activity between Myanmar and THET is Myanmar-UK Health Alliance, which we call in Myanmar is MUKA. It's in fact a key platform to coordinate UK and Myanmar health activities exchange to the benefit of both countries. Such platforms should be built and make it much stronger in other low and middle income countries. Myanmar health community, in fact, is no stranger to UK community. We have hundreds of doctors who are members of Royal Colleges of United Kingdom in different disciplines. Many Myanmar doctors are also working in United Kingdom, even if you know the textbook that our universities of medicine are using are all written by British authors. Medicine, surgery, pediatrics, OB-GYN, pharmacology, pathology, you know, physiology, biochemistry, all are written by British authors. So what I would like to say is that all the Burmese doctors are somewhat similar to the textbooks which are read by the British medical students, which is very good for me. And I think this will be the same for other low and middle income countries. Sincerely, I want THET's presence in low and middle income countries and many developing countries of the world in the context of achieving this Health for All and SDG and equity and equality in healthcare services. Professionals of UK working under the umbrella of THET, UK Department of Health, can take Myanmar experience, good or not so good, while expanding their program in other parts of the world. I want to specifically point out that Myanmar's medical community and THET as a population gained tremendously through the support of this Tropical Health and Education Trust. I wish other low and middle income countries are having similar pattern. By the very nature of this type of support, substantial and concrete benefits are embedded permanently in the Myanmar health domain. It cannot be evaporated like funding support given by many organizations. Funding support will be evaporated, but the technical inputs, the technical support given by THET or UK professionals to Burmese professionals will be permanent, somewhat like it is etching on the stone. I thank you very much for that. The capacity of the medical community and especially the GP are really beneficial to Myanmar. Why? GPs are prevalent in remote, underserved, difficult parts of the country, which is extremely important, and also it is in line with health for all. In other words, people living in remote underserved areas are getting the services of our GP, which they are being trained by UK health professionals as well. If we really want to achieve health for all, my stance, the position is strengthen the human resource from various perspectives, such as technical, ethical, commitment to serve the population. I want to emphasize ethical perspective. This is very important for the whole population. The medical community must be ethical. A person may be however technically top-notch. If he or she is unethical, it will not good for the whole medical community and even to the country. But we are getting this through THET program. Thank you very much to officials of THET. Another area which can lead to achieving health for all is THET support to Myanmar, which is to improve health system performance of low and middle income countries. Here, my only suggestion to THET, UK Department of Health, is that sharing of experience in the realistic down-to-earth manner among the low and middle income countries is very crucial and important, especially in achieving the health for all concept or principles. I wish that the UK Department of Health to kindly consider to happen sooner than later in many low and middle income countries. I'm confident that it will be mutually beneficial to low and middle income countries where challenges, issues, and problems are somewhat similar. The success and solutions of each low and middle income countries can be shared along our path for health for all. I want to speak a little bit more specific about health for all, although it might be an aspirational goal. If we really want to achieve, it should be reflected in the country's overall national policies, in addition to specifically mentioning it in the national health policy and strategies of the country concerned. Even at the program level, many realistic and dual spread strategies must be spelled out and implemented seriously. In fact, it is nothing new but to remind ourselves all the time while we are implementing our health intervention. Another perspective, as equally as important for consideration, is attitude, knowledge, level, and practice of the basic health issues by the population at large. Only then we will be able to achieve the health for all, which is our aspirational goal, in another one decade's time. In Myanmar, we are promoting health literacy as a number one health priority through the use of 8-inch tablet phones by all the basic health service workers, which include midwives, public health supervisor 1, 2, health assistants, lady health visitors, and some nurses. In these tablets, we put everything from A to Z on health issues in layman's context, layman words, and updating it all the time in real-time basis, you know, which is very good. And using these tablets, all the basic health workers are promoting the health literacy level of the country through small talk or small group meeting. This is very important. That is why we have distributed almost 30,000 tablets all over the country to promote this particular activity. I think the people's knowledge, perception, and practice on common health and health-related issues are crucial in our path to achieve health for all. Another area which low and middle income countries or developing countries are facing is there are multitude of UN agencies, NGOs, and local NGOs working at the ground level. We need very strong coordination of works on public health activities and interventions carried out by these entities. There is a lot of duplication and redundancy of work, not only in terms of technical area, but only in terms of geographical areas. These UN agencies, development partners, NGOs, local big NGOs should rethink twice. What they are contributing to low and middle income countries are really functioning in a well-coordinated manner. In Myanmar, we have what we call as Myanmar Health Sector Coordination Committee, where all the UN agencies, development partners, major NGOs, and NGOs are involved as members of this committee. This is at the policy and strategic level. We are striving hard to have similar, smaller committees at the implementation level. If we can achieve this, I am sure that we may be able to achieve this health for all to a certain extent. The notion, I would like to say another thing, the notion of health for all must be embedded deeply in the minds of all stakeholders working at the country level in lower and middle income countries. This is easier said than done. However, we need to strive our level best to make it happen. In low and middle income countries, as far as I know, WHO is a major technical organization, thereby all WHO biennial work plan of action must be quickly reviewed to see that all the work plans are linked in one way or other with the health for all related activities being carried out at the country level. Low and middle income countries also need to develop specific parameters or indicators to assess its own country's situation while we are going for HFA, like, are we achieving HFA? Are we on the way to achieve HFA? Are we unlikely to achieve HFA within the stipulated period of time? Is the progress slow, fast, or stencil? These can be assessed using these simple parameters or indicators using a checklist form of thing, which will take only one or 2 days' time to assess whether the particular area or the particular segment of the country is on the way to HFA or not. This is very important. It is not a big deal. We just need a strong will to achieve it for the sake of the population residing in low and middle income countries. Another area, however small it seems to be, is all the health staff must be fully aware of the true meaning of HFA. Each country may have its own connotations. I would like to emphasize again that development partners working in low and middle income countries to give priority attention on what they are supporting is really facilitating in achieving HFA. That is very important. That is a question to be asked by all the entities working in each and every country. I want to reiterate one particular point in the context of support that we are giving from THET is the role of GP in achieving HFA. We should not forget and we should not underestimate the role of GPs. GPs' role in achieving HFA is as equally important as the role of workers or officials of the Ministry of Health. That is very, very important. The importance of GP and the importance of health workers of the Ministry of Health are almost the same. In my country and in many low and middle income countries, GPs and GP clinics are located all over the country, even in remote, underserved and hard to reach areas. We have to think the role of GP in HFA or enhancing the role of GP. This is very important for my country. And we have a GP society under the Myanmar Medical Association. We are working very hard with that society. After all inclusive approach should be the order of the day if we really want to achieve HFA in a decade's time. Before concluding my talk, I want to mention on behalf of Ministry of Health and Sports, and on behalf of my country, I deeply appreciate and thank profusely the Tropical Health and Education Trust, the UK Department of Health, and the Government of the United Kingdom. Thank you very much, sir.